Make sure you like, subscribe, and hit that bell icon.
Hello, and welcome to Let's Sip and Talk with Freema. So today we have a returning guest on, Mr. Ricky Dobbs, and I just wanted to kind of check in and see what he's up to. And because with all this political stuff going on, not saying we're talking about it, I do know that he's going to run for president in 2040, so I felt it was a great time to have our future president on. So without further ado, Mr. Ricky Dobbs.
Twin wings, Finnerty left, Doyle right, Murray the fullback. Doyle comes in motion to the left. Dobbs on a run to the left. A dive and a touchdown. An NCAA record.
So far away, so alone. But you know it's alright. I came to my senses, let go of my defenses. There's
no green motion from the right wing. Dobbs off play action, looking to throw. And Ricky's going to be able to hook up with Jones down the middle of the field, catching inside the 20 and running into the end zone. Touchdown, Sneavy!
And I'm all in. Nothing left to hide. I'm falling harder than a landslide I've been.
Catani the fullback. Doyle motions right to left. Dobbs off the fake to Catani. Running it left. A Navy touchdown! A Navy victory! To the right, looking to throw, pulls up, releases deep downfield for John Howell, makes the catch at the 35, feeling the way to the 20, to the 10, to the 5, goodbye! Touchdown, Navy! Twin slots for the mids, Corey motions to the right. Dobbs up the inside thick, runs it left, slips ahead, at the five with a touchdown for Navy. Ricky Dobbs again breaking a tackle.
calling out your name even. If I lose the game, I'm all in. I'm all in for life. And I'm all in, nothing left to hide. I'm falling harder than a man.
Dobbs off play action, into the pocket, looking to throw. Airs it out deep down the left side for a wide open Greg Jones. Goodbye. From the 40 to the 30. He's all by his lonesome to the 10. It's a touchdown for Navy. Throw, steps up, rifles a laser down the middle, and the catch made by Turner, a touchdown, maybe, what a throw, Dobbs connecting with Turner.
Hello.
Well, hello there.
Hey, welcome back to Let's Sip and Talk with Freema. I appreciate you coming on. How are you doing tonight?
I'm doing well. Thanks for having me again.
Of course. So, you know, during everything that's going on, I felt it was a good time to have you back on, Mr. 2040. That's what I'm going to call you. So, I read some things in your autobiography that Alan written up that you had Obama, you know, President Obama, I still say President Obama, like signed, was it like your trophies, your hats? What was that?
Okay, so this happened while I was at the Naval Academy. We went there, like when he first got inaugurated. Of course, before he got inaugurated, I had said that I was going to be the first black president before he even ran. So in 2006 is when I said it initially, and then in 2007, I said it in an interview on national TV in 7 and 8, and then while he was running. Then when he got inaugurated in the January of 2009, we was going to the White House after winning the Commander-in-Chief trophy. The Navy football team, once we won the Commander-in-Chief trophy, we was going to the White House to meet President Obama. And I was like, man, like I'm going to get noticed by him some way. So I was like, we gave him a helmet that was like his gift. That year, we gave him helmet and all the players signed. And what I said, I was like, I get my like autograph on there. And then in five places, like in the front, the back, both sides, and on top of the helmet, I wrote Ricky Dobbs on there five times, just so if whenever he'll look at it, he'll be rotating around and be like, dang, either they got like five or Dobbs got. So that many times. So the next year when we would go, given if we went, which we ended up going, I was like, I want him to call me out and be like, who is this Ricky Dobbs guy? And it just so happened though that next year he called me out for breaking the NCAA record, and he basically endorsed me for running for president too.
Wow, that's amazing. So your strategy worked, huh?
Oh, yeah, it worked.
So I know the last time you were on, we kind of didn't go into too much detail because that was kind of the end when you mentioned that. So what made you decide, you know what, I want to run for president one day? What came in your mind that said that's something that you want to do and that you're going to do?
So it started in high school. When I was in high school, I guess pretty much before that, but in high school is when it became like, to be labeled as me being like a politician.
Okay.
So because I know just about everybody, and I made it a point to go around to some of the kids who most people probably wouldn't talk to in high school, who were considered like the uncool, less popular kids. Mm-hmm. And I would always make conversation and ask them how they're going. And then one of the things I started doing, more so my senior year, is during my lunch period, I would go around. I had this little motto. I was like, you know, how Jesus, they say in the Bible, Jesus like washed your feet. I used to go around and scratch people back.
Okay.
So in lunch, I would go around And people who didn't know me, and I ain't really know them, this is my way of getting to know them. I would go around and then I hit pat them on the back. And then I'd be scratching their back while I'm talking to them. Like, hey, man, how you doing? What's going on? And I'm introducing myself. And then some of them already knew who I was, but they just never had any kind of interaction.
Right. So that's a strategy right there. That's a marketing strategy.
Exactly. So I was doing that through like all the lunch periods. And then another thing in high school, I was one of the students who the teachers like would allow to skip like parts of class. And I never got in trouble for it, only because the real reason, like everybody would be like, you know, all the kids would be like, you know, the teachers give me special privilege just because I'm a quarterback and all this stuff, or mm-hmm. I also played basketball in high school too.
Okay.
But I was like, you know, it ain't got nothing to do with that. The real reason that they let me do this is because I used to keep all of my friends who I grew up with, or just kids who would be like problem child, mm-hmm. problem children, for disrespecting teachers and or just trying to cut class. I would be policing, getting them to go to class and do different things. Like, so that was the real reason why nobody really, a lot of people didn't really see that except for the kids that was like in trouble a lot.
Right.
So I would be going to talk to different students, telling, you know, like, man, just sit down, be quiet in class or get to class. And for that, they gave me this award called the Faculty Cup, because all the teachers was on my side, like was, you know, grateful for the interaction that I had and the respect that I had from all the students. So they gave me that because I helped them out a lot. And then they was like, you know, you're such a politician, all of this. And I was like, you know, and they nicknamed me. I was called in high school the mayor.
And, oh, wow.
That name has actually stuck with me, the mayor of many places I've been. So they, you know, called me the mayor a lot of places because of this politician-like demeanor that I have as far as
right.
and getting to know people and all of that stuff. But for me, it just come from a genuine spot of my heart. And then I looked at it and I was like, you know, me being the ultimate people's person, you know, in life, just going back to one of the things we talked about in our last session, as far as, you know, some of the dreams and goals that you have and figure out what your passion is. And my passion is people. So I was like, you know, me being a people's person, the ultimate people person, in my opinion, is the president of the United States. You can have the biggest impact on the world.
Absolutely.
So I was like, why not run for president? Try to make the world a better place, one smile at a time. And
Absolutely.
So I was like, you know, I'm gonna run for president. And then that stuck on. I went to the Naval Academy Prep School in 2006 after I graduated. And then the same kind of talk was from this guy, Mr. Kazee. And he was a doctor there for all the sports guys and stuff. So he was like, he said, Ricky, you should run for president. I said, yeah, I'm going to run one day. And then with the conversation with him is the day that I picked the year. In 2006, I told him, I said, I'm going to run for president in 2040. And
wow.
Not really thinking too much of it. Turns out, you know, years later, I figured out that 2040 is the actual election year. If long as nothing tragic happens. And
right, of course.
But it's an election year. So I'll run in 2040 and then get inaugurated in 2041.
Oh, you claiming it, honey. You are claiming it. So do you feel like you have to act a certain way, put on a certain persona? Is it certain things that you would want to do but can't do because you know that you have this path that you're taking? Is it hard?
So that's one of the things that I would like to say, you know, that I'm going to try to have a unique approach to, because I have some friends of mine who, you know, care a lot about my aspirations and whatnot. So they was telling me, you know, Ricky, you got to make sure that you're doing this and doing that and not doing this and that. And, you know, I looked at it and I was like, you know, why would I not live my life? Because the things that you go through in your life is kind of get you to a point to where you're actually like, where you learn from some of your mistakes. And so I was just like, you know, this is going to be very like a pivotal point for me to where I'm going to use this as not really watch and live my life cautiously. I'm going to live my life to the fullest, and then occurred, you know, things that I, you know, mistakes along the way. But I really understand that those mistakes and stuff in life is what help you be that better person. So if I live cautiously, I might not learn all the lessons that I need to learn in order to be the best presidential candidate.
Absolutely.
They were like, well, how you gonna come back there? You know, you probably shouldn't drink. You probably shouldn't do this. And I was like, well, look, this is gonna be like, you know, first time in the interview where I done said this to a couple of people, but this is gonna be one of my pitches, and this, we're gonna be able to look back on this 20 years from now, looking back 20 years ago, and say this is one of the first times that I said it. Because it was like, you know, Ricky, you need to watch what you're doing. And I'm like, this is gonna be my pitch. You know, me, I'm no better than you are. I am the American people. I'm just like you. I'm just asking you to be the representative. I don't think that I'm better than you. So please don't put me on this pedestal to where I be looked at as the person who has, like, you know, who walks on water. Like, I'm the same as you. And there are things that I've done in my past that I wish I might not have done. But at the same time, those things actually helped me become the person that I am. So, absolutely. And I'm going to put it out there to anybody who is going to be a critic and say, I'm saying, now, if you have things in your life, if you lived your life and don't have things that you wish you might not have done that made you better, then by all means, you're too perfect. You're more perfect than I am. So you come up here and I will endorse you to run for president.
That's good, because it's the truth, and I say this all the time. Without our life experiences, without our, I don't want to say failures, but without going through things, how do we know what, you know, we need to get better at? Or, you know, how are we going to grow if we don't, you know, fail a little bit? Or you get what I'm saying? Like, we're not perfect. So I appreciate you saying that, because I would want a president that is, you know, relatable, that can understand, that been through things, you know. So I think that's a good thing. I think that's a very, very good thing.
And that's one of the things that, you know, I'll be 33 at the end of this month. And through 32 and some change years in my life, one of the things that I've learned, you know, life is a lot of life is about relationships.
Right.
And, you know, whether that's in person or through some type of medium, whether it be the TV or the telephone, whatever the case may be. But a lot of times people don't really think about the word relationship. Right. The root word is relate. So if you have a president or a person that is in a position that you can relate to, then you're going to have, like, feel like you have a relationship with that person. Like, just for instance, not many people can look at President Trump right now and feel like they have a personal relationship with him, because it's not questions you might be able to relate with him on. So
right.
That's why, you know, and another one of my endorsements, I'm giving away one of these nuggets. He told me, former Secretary of Defense Robert Gates, he told me, he said, Ricky, get involved in as much as you can and at least do it for 3 years. Because that's when you become, 3 years is the amount of time it takes to become what they consider to be an expert at something.
Okay.
So then nobody can be able to question you about all those things. Because me in the Navy, I'm a service warfare officer, and it's been said that, you know, our motto is we're a jack of all trades because we do a whole lot of things. See, my motto in my life, based off of that advice and just how I am naturally, is I'm a jack of all trades and a master of many. So get involved in a lot, so that way by the time I get ready to run for president, I'm going to get to a point, and then a lot of the American people are going to be like, man, this guy, he had NFL aspirations, then make it, but he had the aspirations, played football in a collegiate level, served in the military, and then became, like, involved with kids, doing a whole lot of things. So I'm going to try to, you know, get involved with all these things so a lot of the American people can be able to relate to me and the things that I'm trying to do as far as the way it comes with the country, the city, or whatever aspect in area that I decide to run in.
Absolutely, absolutely. So where are you located now?
I'm in Norfolk, Virginia.
In Virginia. Okay, so you're not far from us. So being that you're running for president in 2040, like, are you already out there? Like, I know you mentioned children and things of that sort. Are you already out there in the community? Like, what are you doing now to go ahead and continuously mold yourself for this?
So one of the best things that I do now is just kind of keep the conversation going. And most of the time, I've been slacking off on it the last year and a half since I just came from Bahrain. But I have a nonprofit foundation where I try to reach back and do events and stuff for kids. But
okay.
To kind of push them on the right track. and then just to continue to network. Being in the Navy, trying to push it up, you know, reach out to those individuals who are in positions of power and just continue to develop relationships with people who are my peers below and above as well. Because 20 years from now, who knows where a lot of them are going to go.
Absolutely.
But I'm pretty sure a lot of our paths will cross again. And if I'm in a position, they might have a different area of expertise. Like, for instance, you, I'm going to use you when it comes to kind of time for campaign and all that. So people that I come across to be able to help me to make it a community effect.
Absolutely.
So networking would be, to answer your question, it would be to keep it right now, keep the conversation going. So when people won't lose sight of it. And two is to continue to network and build relationships.
And that's absolutely what we need, you know, to go for. Someone said, go for it, brother.
Appreciate it, Don.
He already put it in there. He said, when I get inaugurated, you know, so he's already put it out there. He said, but yes, Freema is right to start to get your name out there. Absolutely. Because Ricky Dobbs is going to be a household name in the future for our children. Our children are going to be voting for Ricky Dobbs, you know, when they become grown. So it's good to start now. It's never too early. So, you know, like, this is amazing. And I feel good. Not saying I'm psychic, not saying I have some powers or whatever, but just to know I'm speaking with our next president in 2040 feels great. And like I told you before, I'm definitely, I don't know, how old would I be in 2040? Oh my God, I'll be old.
You won't be that old.
I promise you I'll be old. But yeah, as they say, black don't crack. So I'll still be looking good while I'm helping you campaign for your presidency. I plan on doing that. I do want to ask you this, and of course you don't have to answer if you feel uncomfortable about it. But with everything that's going on that went on, that I pray does not continue to go on in our near future, there was a big thing with the Black Lives Matter, you know, with the peaceful protests and everything. And then now I see that supposedly there may be an armed protest in the future. If you were president, like, how do you feel, or what do you know, as far as how would you handle such situations? How would you try to disengage, if that's a word, something from happening in that manner? You know, an armed protest. Like, what would you say to the world, you know, as President Ricky Dobbs? What would you say to kind of cease everything that has went on?
So one of the things I would say is, you know, I would definitely put my voice out there to be able to tell, you know, the American people, number one, based off our Constitution, they do have the right to protest. So the means that you protest, that's one thing I would tell them to consider. Coming out armed and all of that, what's the purpose?
Right.
If you were coming out armed, that means that you're planning to meet resistance with resistance.
Right.
So I would just remind them that there is a difference between peaceful protest, which means that we will be put in place just to supervise and make sure things don't get out of hand, but we have to be armed. But if you come here unarmed, then that will let me know, okay, if I'm a government official or a police officer or National Guard, whoever it may be, now I have a group of individuals who are coming up unarmed. That means that they don't intend to meet me, the government, with resistance.
Right.
So So that means I could tone things down. But when you have armed protests, that is a whole nother message. So now the light that we should, as a government or anybody, like just as an example, if I told you I'm gonna come to your house, I don't agree with the things that you might have said or done, then, and I'm gonna come there peacefully. I'm just gonna come there and I wanna talk to you. Now you got the right to defend your house because it's your house. So you can come out and talk to me. You might have a gun, or somebody might have a gun to make sure things don't get out of hand when we talk, just so you can hear me out, hear my protest. But now if I tell you I'm coming to your house and I'm coming armed, now you're going to have a different look
at absolutely
it, a different approach. Now you're going to be geared up to protect yourself and protect your home. It's the same way. So given, like, just using, because what you asked, the Black Lives Matter event, I don't think that it should have been met with that type of resistance, like, from the government. It should not have been there because it was a peaceful protest. Nobody was armed.
Right.
But to know that people are the same way any other protest, now if that's going to be the way that they're going to meet our protest, then that needs to be the way that the government, we will meet our protest.
Right, right.
If you're armed or unarmed, we're going to come with this same resistance. Like, we don't want you to do this, but then now, what am I doing as a government? I'm trying to shut down your right to protest. So you have a right to protest, but I don't think, I mean, you can correct me if I'm wrong, because I ain't read it verbatim to know, but I don't think that it says that we have the right to protest with resistance or with arms, because the amendments are separate.
Right.
We do have the right to bear arms, but it doesn't say we have the right to bear arms at a protest.
At a protest.
So, I mean, it is tricky, but now I digress. I'm going to go back and try to answer your question. If you said, what I would say, like I would tell people today, if you are going to come and protest, make sure, excuse me, make sure that you come here correctly.
Right.
These protests are all fine. I would come here and then I will hear you out. And if I was a president, we will hear you out. But if you come here armed, we don't need to hear you, because now you're not coming out. You're coming to show force.
Yeah, you're already coming with a whole different mindset, you know? Like,
so, and then, and really what that is it's a threat. It's an idle threat. I'm coming with a gun because I'm telling you, if you don't hear me or if I don't get my way, I'm prepared to use this.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So the differences, the differences. And I mean, I don't agree with the way things have been going. I mean, and it's only showing true colors, which is a reality where no matter how much people will try to deny some of the truths that we have here in America, I mean, you can deny it all you want, but all you got to do is just look at the differences.
Absolutely. Yeah. Where do you think the world, where do you think the U.S., where do you think we'll be in 2040? What battle, and I hate to say battle, but what do you feel you'll be taking on? Like, what is your vision? What do you think will be going on in 2040?
So based off of, I'm only speaking based off of history.
Right.
I mean, I hate to say it, but I think it may be the same battle.
Really?
Because based off of history, way back when, was fighting the same battle, different ways, and it still has been no reform, no change, none of that. It's coming in a different light, you know, and I truly hope that it doesn't escalate and get out of hand to where it'd be like fighting this battle from a whole different point of view. I don't know. I don't know. I hope within 20 years, we a drastic change, which the first thing I think is the recognition. We recognize it and then admit it, and then we can address it accordingly. Because the more and more you try to, like, say this is not it, and then try to cover it up, sugarcoat it, and all this stuff, we need to face it head on. And then,
absolutely, I agree.
We'll see a change.
I agree 100%, 100%. You know, and of course, you know, with our interviews, I don't like to keep you too long, but not even to switch paths that we're taking, but just on a lighter note, when you're campaigning, why, like, what is expecting, of the people that's campaigning for you? Like, or is it just more of like a promotional aspect? Look at me, so I know what my job entails when it comes. Is it more of a promotional aspect, putting you out there? Like, what does that entail? Is that something you're already working on so you'll know what you want when that time comes?
So as far as the campaign, what my campaign, I think it's going to be, one of the things is, of course, is the equality.
Okay.
So not more so me, it's going to be just the aspirations and like the vision that we're going to be promoting. And hopefully that will be associated with me because I'm going to be talk about it so much. So when we're promoting it, we're going to promote it by everybody who's involved in the campaign and is going to promote it by their living also, their interactions and living.
Gotcha.
Because we're all going to pay for the same stuff and, you know, push out the same kind of information. We're going to push out the same, you know, I don't want to say, because I do have some of the stuff already that I, you know.
I wanted to ask, but I was like, let me not put him on Front Street because I want to know, like, 2040 is, you know, I don't want to say too far because these years be rolling around, but do you already kind of know what you're going to stand for? Do you already know what, you know, your commercial is going to be about? Do you know what President Ricky Dobbs stand for already? You get what I'm saying?
Yeah, I do.
Wow. Okay.
So I have the idea. Now, of course, through these years, they may change.
Mm-hmm.
But so I'm going to tell you, this is where a lot of, this is probably so far, I think, my entire life. My 10th grade year, I was a sophomore in high school. And that was probably the most creative year of my life so far. Because even now, still today, 32-year-old me is looking at 16-year-old me and taking some of the things that I had as ideas then and kind of like tweaking it and, you know, trying to expand on it. So like I created like my autograph that I was going to have for my whole time. I was in 10th grade when I said that I was going to, I even wrote my mom. I had said I was going to be, go to the NFL and all this stuff. And then I said the president too. But I told my mom, wrote her a letter and told her that I was going to, I wrote it in the 8th grade, but then I fine-tuned it in my sophomore year when I told her that I was going to take care of her and I was going to be someone that everybody looks up to at some point. Let me see. I said that I wanted a girl for my first child.
Okay.
And I came up with her name when I was in the 10th grade. she's 6 now today. I had so many ideas as a sophomore in high school, and this is when I came up with something that I was going to stand on like forever, and I still do.
And still
like, things now, this is going to be like, you know, just give you kind of a hint, because I do it now every time. If anybody ever seen me or, you know, had an opportunity to have a drink or a shot with me for your birthday or whatever, everybody know what I'm gonna say, like times. And one of the things is like this thing is moments. I tell everybody this is a toast of moments, living every one of them and never let one pass you by.
Absolutely.
Cause once it's gone, you ain't gonna be able to get it back.
You're not so, getting it back.
Now a piece of that is in this whole thing that I'm gonna stand on when I run for president, and cause it's gonna start before that too. When I run for mayor, governor of Georgia, and then president. So
how soon is all this going to happen? I'm excited. How soon How soon is all this going to happen?
So a lot of it was dependent upon my military career.
Okay.
I said that I wanted to start my political, like, career campaign type thing when, like, by running for mayor of my hometown, Georgia. But, so, if I retire from the military, that'll put me in retirement at 2030, so 10 years.
Okay.
So, I have about between 9 and 10 years of what I thought if I retired from the military, from the Navy, to do the whole little track as far as running for mayor, governor, and then trying to run for president. It's a short timeline. But right now, with this track at all, I may be out of the Navy active duty by May of 2022.
Oh, wow.
That will speed things up to where I could kind of, you know, plant my feet and get things rolling and start becoming big. Like, now, the first thing that I want to do is expand on my nonprofit to be able to make a footprint into the community.
Absolutely. And then so this is going to come sooner than you expected if, you know, you do retire in 2022.
Yep.
Wow. So Miss Sandra West Williams said, do you have a vision and a mission statement? Just something to think about.
Yeah, so I have that for my nonprofit. I have the vision and mission statement. But now, as far as when I run for president, a lot of that stuff is gonna kind of work off of each other.
Right.
Because the plan that I had set forth is gonna be like a little stepping stone all the way through. So from things I used to say when I was playing football at the Naval Academy, different things from what I was telling kids and just stand what I stand on, my core values, to what I'm going to incorporate in my nonprofit, to when I start campaigning. A lot of that stuff is going to be building blocks to step off of each other. And then at the end of it all, it's going to put everything together.
Wow, that's amazing. I'm proud of you. I must say that. Miss Sandra Williams also said, the word said, write the vision and make it plain.
Mm.
Absolutely. I love it. But Ricky, you know go ahead. I'm sorry.
To Miss Sandra, mm-hmm. like you said, she's gonna write the vision and make it plain. So the vision, that's Alabama.
Yeah.
Vision and the statement and the vision was written first, and everything else was kind of like going back, so backtracking, so I could continue to lead back up to it until it is. And it is plain. It's real simple, and it's gonna be straight, direct. But I just can't wait to be able to put everything into fruition, to be able to put it all together.
Well, I'm excited. You know, I'm excited because I was able to meet you. You get what I'm saying? Even from the first time, and just to know to meet somebody with that type of vision, that type of, you know, I don't know, just someone who wants to make a change, because that's my goal is to make a change, you know, in a community, whether it's giving knowledge by having you guys on, just spread knowledge verbally. You know, if you can't do it any other way, let's share our knowledge verbally, help somebody else out. So to meet someone like you and know that you're going to make it and that's your vision, it's been your vision since school, is amazing. So I am honored to have met you. I appreciate you coming on 100%. Ms. Williams said, good job. Good job. Let's work and get ready to go. Absolutely.
Yes, ma'am.
Absolutely. I'm excited because I know that I am going to help you any way, shape, or form that I can when that time comes, or even before that time comes. So, you know, we kind of have the same goals, is to help people make a change. And that's what I want to do. So I'm willing to help you in any way I can. So just, you know, keep me abreast, keep me in the know, and let me know whatever it is I can do to help on my end. Before we do end, because I don't want to hold you too long, is there anything else, any knowledge, any motivation, any inspirational words that you would like to give to the viewers?
One of the things I would definitely say is don't wait till tomorrow. Start now. Whatever it is that, you know, that you've been thinking about doing, you know, if you whether it's eating right, working out, and this is also a message to myself. Don't wait till tomorrow. Start today. Tomorrow is not promised. And that ties back into the moments. You got to live in every moment and start at that time because the next one is not promised. So,
absolutely. That's the best advice you can give because we have procrastinators out there. We have people that say, I'll do it tomorrow. I'll do it next week. Do it today. Write it down before you forget about it because right. We do forget things, you know? So, Ricky, again, I appreciate you coming on. It means the world to me just to know that I have met you, that you were willing to come on a second time, and that I know that I talked to our president before he became president. So I'm going to pop my collar on that one. Miss West said that it's correct. Say what you mean and mean what you say. Absolutely. Stand behind it. You know, don't let nobody influence you unless it's the right way. So, Ricky Dobbs, we're going to go ahead and end it here. I want to thank everybody that tuned in, that, you know, asked questions, gave feedback, like, comment, shared. I appreciate all of you. Ricky, I appreciate you coming on. It means the world to me. And she said, and last, you believe it before you see it. Absolutely. Believe in yourself. Absolutely. And as we always say on Let's Sip and Talk with Freema, peace and love.
Wait, Freema.
Huh?
Where's your drink?
Oh, right here. Bam.
Okay.
So cheers. We're going to cheers really quickly to we're cheersing to future president Ricky Dobbs 2040 and Miss Let's Sip and Talk, which I probably not going to say that on a campaign, but Madel Kennedy is campaigning in Orangeburg for future president Ricky Dobbs. Cheers.
To the moment.
I appreciate it.
Because look, last time we said we ain't going to make this.
You're right. You're absolutely right. 100%. Thanks for catching me on that. I'd be so engaged in the moment because this is exciting for me, to be honest with you. But that's why. That's all. But thank you so much. I appreciate it. And stay on for me once we disconnect, okay?
Okay.
All right, great. Peace and love, everybody.